please be seated. Welcome to our Eucharist this morning. As ever, we welcome you on this, the third Sunday of Easter. And as ever, we're operating under slightly different circumstances. And we're going to hear, first of all, a recording of our choir, which includes also those who aren't able to be with us in person. So it's lovely to hear them. You can follow the words and hum along to the hymn, "We Have a Gospel to Proclaim." Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Hallelujah, Christ is risen. St. Paul writes to the church in Corinth, "Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us rejoice by putting away all malice and evil, confessing our sins with a sincere and a true heart. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We say together, glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, We praise you for your glory. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father. Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest. Let us pray. Almighty Father, who in your great mercy gladden the disciples with the sight of the risen Lord, give us such knowledge of his presence with us, that we may be strengthened and sustained by his risen life, and serve you continually in righteousness and truth. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who's alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. That's it for our first Bible readings.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
While the 11 and their companions were talking about what they had heard, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet and see that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were still disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. A young man flees from the Russian Revolution and as a teenager settles in Paris in the early 1920s. Up until now he has not had an easy life, but at last he has the freedom to study. And study he does, graduating in physics, chemistry and biology, and finally a doctorate in medicine. But life, he finds, is meaningless. In despair he writes, "I could not accept aimless happiness. Happiness seemed to be stale if it had no further meaning. I began to look for a meaning in life. Studying and making oneself useful for life didn't convince me at all. All my life up till now had been concentrated on immediate goals, and suddenly these became empty." And then a chain of events begin that are to change his life forever. He is invited by a student group leader to a lecture given by a priest. Unwillingly, he attends, but much of what the priest is saying about Christianity is profoundly unacceptable to him. However, his curiosity is stirred, and determined to discover the truth, he hurries home to ask his mother whether she has a copy of the Gospels. It is while he is reading the beginning of St. Mark's Gospel and has reached the third chapter that he is suddenly aware that there is a presence on the other side of the desk. The former Eastern Orthodox Archbishop Anthony Bloom was later to write, "The certainty was so strong that it was Christ standing there that it has never left me." This was the real turning point. Because Christ was alive and I have been in his presence, I could say with certainty that what the gospel said about the crucifixion of the prophet of Galilee was true. History I had to believe, the resurrection I knew as a fact. It was a direct and personal experience. Down through the centuries, a myriad Christian souls have had personal encounters with the living Lord. Today, the resurrection of the Lord continues to be a matter for debate among many church scholars as to whether it is a historical fact. Yet countless Christians believe in the real physical presence of Jesus that revealed his resurrection. I believe that belief in the resurrection is central to our faith and the basis upon which the church itself grew. But beginning with the gospel story from Luke that we have just heard, what are the implications for our own lives? Now, we often find when reading the gospel that its stories are all the more compelling and believable because the conduct of the disciples is something we can instantly recognize and identify with. Luke tells us that the disciples were startled and frightened, thinking they were seeing a ghost. Most normal people would be scared, in fact terrified, if someone they knew had recently died, suddenly appeared in the room with them. Luke speaks of the disciples' joy and amazement. It is hard to imagine the joy if the person we were mourning suddenly appeared alive, if that which we had thought was lost forever was restored to us, if the tragedy and pain of death were suddenly taken away. Luke tells us that Jesus is at pains to calm the fears of the disciples and reassure them that he really is a living presence and not an illusion. By all gospel accounts, Jesus has a living body, but it is not a body like ours. The resurrected body of the Lord can pass through walls and appear in a locked room. It is not subject to natural laws as we know them of time and space. The resurrected body of Jesus presents to us a new and different reality. Understandably, to the disciples, this defies all reason and shatters all theories of the world they have had until now. To reassure them, Jesus invites them to touch him, and he shows them his hands and his feet, scarred with torture. He wants to reassure them that this is not some illusion or magic trick, but that he is real and alive and present, though in a way they do not understand. Luke tells us that Jesus even eats in front of them. Perhaps he did so to reassure, to calm, to soothe anxious and fearful minds. The beauty is in the detail. Broiled fish might not sound very appealing to some, but I suppose it is all they had to offer. And no doubt some commentators will invest this little detail with some theological significance. And by his willingness to meet the disciples where they are at, we recognize this Jesus, the Jesus who heals and reassures, the Jesus who raised from the dead, the Lord whose message throughout the Gospels is, "Do not be afraid." Humankind, says the poet T.S. Eliot in the poems known as the Four Quartets, cannot bear very much reality. We are no different to those disciples to whom Jesus first appeared. Suffering has huge reality in our lives, and so has joy. Sometimes reality, whether of joy or sorrow, takes us by surprise, and we stand silent, dumbfounded, unable to take it all in. Sometimes reality seems almost surreal, too intense, too vivid. Is this really happening? We ask. Sometimes good news is more difficult to believe than bad news. Bad news we can usually take. Bad news is more often the norm. Bad news happens every day. But good news? News of unlooked-for release from suffering, news of the restoration of something we had thought was irredeemably lost, news of unearned grace and reconciliation. These things leave us speechless and unsure, wanting to believe, but hesitant, ready for the worst, should it all turn out to be an illusion. So we can well believe that the disciples were hesitant and unsure. unable to take it all in. Renowned priest and author Henri Nguyen was to write that those who saw Jesus had their lives completely changed. What had seemed to be the end proved to be the beginning. What had seemed to be a cause for fear proved to be a cause for courage. What had seemed to be defeat proved to be victory, he writes. The hope of the resurrection of the body is a central belief in three of the world's great religions, Islam, Judaism, and Christianity. The resurrection of the Lord was the tinder that would set the early world alight and saw the rapid spread of Christianity in a world that had largely hitherto worshipped pagan gods. It proclaimed that the Christian God was the God of the living. The resurrection of Jesus was the reply of God to the historical inevitability of death. The victory of the resurrection was the victory over sin, over evil, over the fallen nature of mankind. As St. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. Indeed, St. Paul stresses belief in the resurrection as fundamental to our Christian belief and states that this stupendous act of God is the forerunner to a deeply personal event for each and every living soul. The hope of the resurrection of our own bodies, the hope stated in Psalm 118, that I shall not die but live. The hope stated in Job 19, for I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God. Because we believe that Jesus rose from the dead, we have hope. The hope which, according to St. Paul, is like labor pains. This is a hope which acknowledges that we live in a fallen world, a world where children starve in Yemen, where Rohingya and Syria and refugee crisis have become commonplace words, a world where the innocent suffer, where heartbreak is never far away, but which still, in the words of the poet Francis Thompson, clings ever to heaven by the hems, as it were. This is the hope of fragile beings in a world where sickness and disease can come without warning and death can be sudden. The lockdown from which we are very gradually emerging came upon us suddenly and stayed with us so very long, long anxious months during which we experienced isolation, death, and fear, and personal tragedy, months during which many of our lives were changed forever, months which changed the world and how we live and breathe and interact with each other. But now, with spring, comes new life and hope. This is the hope of freedom from our pain, our fragility, our vulnerability to death and illness. This is the ability which exists in each and every one of us to bounce back from failure and defeat. This is our capacity to grow and adapt to a different world, to that which we knew pre-lockdown. This is our joy in the discovery of life renewed, knowing, as the Easter message tells us, that to live it fully, we must die first. Archbishop Anthony Bloom was to write, the joy of the resurrection is something we must learn to experience, but we can experience it only if we first learn the tragedy of the cross. To rise again, we must die, he says. Die to our hampering selfishness, die to our fears, die to everything which makes our world so narrow, so cold, so poor, so cruel. die so that our souls may live, may rejoice, may discover the spring of life. These are beautiful, glorious days of spring. Martin Luther once wrote, "The Lord has written the promise of the resurrection, not in books alone, but in every leaf in springtime." Every spring we are privileged to live through should remind us of the resurrection and the promise of new and transformed life. As the world turns on its axis and the days grow longer and warmer, as our hearts rediscover the warmth and beauty around us, may we learn to live with joy and with hope in our risen Lord. Amen.
Stand to affirm our faith in the words of the Creed on page 6. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. All of us. these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We stand for the peace. St. John writes, the risen Christ came and stood amongst his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then were they glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And so as far as we're able, we share the peace together. Risen Lord Jesus Christ, we believe you, and all we have heard is true. When you break bread, may we recognize you as the fire that burns within us, that we may bring light to the world. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, almighty and eternal Father. And in these days of Easter, to celebrate with joyful hearts the memory of your wonderful works. For by the mystery of his passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and hell, and restored in men and women the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise, and open to them the gate of life eternal. And so, in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness, while angels and archangels and the powers of all creation sing forever the hymn of your glory. praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, the broken bread and wine outpoured. May be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends. And taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised you, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes. Justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favor on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Near with faith, receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. pray together. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. I published the banns of marriage between Martin Joseph Cullen and Angela Jean Stevens, both of this parish. If you know any cause or just impediment why these persons should not be joined together in holy matrimony, you are to declare it, and this is the second time of asking. Do please take your booklets home with you and pray for the people who ask for, and please take them home, just for safety. It's good to not have them knocking around for others to clear up. I'm sure you'll be eager to read them anyway, but just in case. Just to say, we're still very limited, of course, in what we can do and what activities we can hold, particularly inside. But you'll see some things are beginning to happen, some of them virtual, some of them in reality, as it were. So Bible discovery. And then we're coming up to our APCM, our sort of annual general meeting, on Wednesday week. That will be entirely by Zoom, because although we're allowed to gather for worship, we're still not allowed to gather for other purposes. Another sort of virtual thing is a Christian Aid quiz in May. So as I say, you'll see that the timetable of things is basically worship meeting, as we would normally do, but nearly everything else having to be done online, at least for the next month and a bit. Now, you can hum along. The choir are going to sing. I mean, I suppose you could all just dance along, really. I think that's probably allowed. So do feel free to dance while the choir sing "I Danced in the Morning." Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He has given us new hope and life. He has raised Jesus from the dead. God has claimed us as his own. He has brought us out of darkness. He has made us light to the world. Alleluia, Christ is risen. God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.